Okay, well, I am very happy that you are a holographer and a lot of the people that have before me, so you will allow me to also validation, determination, the real purpose of this talk is I would like to present to all of you methods that we will put more emphasis on the method that was developed to validate reported NMR structures that even if we don't think that they are good ones, but we class them. And we want to validate at residue level. I will explain what validation is. In addition, how this information can be used to determine protein structure. Now, when we talk about validate structure, they will also say very well, X-ray and NMR, so it's smaller. And why we need to validate structure, we will explain now. First, the outline. We will talk about validation in NMR protein structure. We will give an overview about web server for validation of protein structure. We will talk very briefly about web server for chemical shift prediction. We will present the new methods for validation and refinement of protein structures. And we show how chemical shift, hopefully, we show how use chemical shift to determine protein structures. In some confusion. Now the first question is why the structure of a protein must be validated? The reason that proteins are inconvenient is and the reason why we can see the physical reason because the details of the image that we can see the frame of the length of the wavelength that will be irradiated. And proteins are here which are very far, far from visible light. So, because we cannot see that people develop what method. The most popular one that Rodolfo showed for 90% of the protein data bank is the positive structure as solved by cristallography, which probably people who talk about cristallography already explained. You have a protein, you form a crystal, then you obtain the diffraction pattern. From the diffraction pattern, you need three things: frequency, intensity, and phase. Frequency and intensity is very easy from the source of the light that you have to use to produce the diffraction, but the phase is a big problem. When you solve the phase problem, you have what is called electron density map. Then you try to make it fit into the electron density. And then you will decide several times to produce a good structure. Now, NMR spectroscopy is quite different. Why? Because what you do, and also very well, you collect a series of constraints that you are supposed to satisfy in order to build a structure. And the source of these restraints are mainly NOEs, which provide also hydrogen bond will provide with also the and this in a coupling constant that he showed is the famous Carpus equation that I believe that Rodolfo won't give the Nobel Prize because of this equation. But this Carpus equation provides information about one torsion and five of the back. When you put all together, then you build the structure. But the problem of NMR is it never produce enough constraint or restraint to build a unique structure. So what you get in NMR, this is ubiquity. This is ubiquity sorted by X-ray at 1.8 angstrom resolution, and this is 128 structures sorted by NMR. We can see here and here, look like they are big difference, simply not. This is a bundle of conformation, and you don't have a unique structure again, because you don't have enough information on NMR to build one structure. Now the question is, are the structures in solution one or several? And then we will come to this problem. So NMR produces ensemble of structures. next step is a structural quality. An X-ray is guaranteed because in X-ray crystallography, structural quality can be globally and accurately assessed using what is called the R factor. I will not spend time explaining what the R factor, by the way. I can speak to the organizers later and talk at this. You don't need to write anything. Yes, I will provide. But in NMR spectroscopy, no generally accepted systematic procedure exists to evaluate the structure of the structural quality. So Rodolfo mentioned in his talk that people, what they use is the number of constraint violations, usually from NOE. NOEs provide different. So when you violate, depending on the number of violations, you design the quality of the report. Or you say the R is maybe across the ensemble, again, Rodolfo explained very well, this provides information about decision but not accuracy. Accuracy will be much more related with constraint violation. And usually sometimes people set the number of constraints per ratio to work, because when you have more constraints, you are supposed to have better structure, not always happen. So the problem is big, yes. The structural quality is especially critical for protein structure NMR. And this is not say, but me, but a lot of his spectroscopy. This is from Monteleone group. This is from Woodridge Nobel Prize. That's also good to mention in this talk, for providing method to use NMR to determine. So it's a big problem. So there, historically, I want just to mention very briefly several. That's probably the first one, which is called What If by Green in 1990. I will talk very briefly. Later appeared Project in 1993. ESVS is a suite program. It's protein suite validation structure or something like that by the Monteleone group. And then we introduce what we call a physics-based method. I will say why this phase against previous validation method where people call knowledge phase because they use deposited structure. I mean information, we don't use any deposited structure to build the method, we build the method from the set now. What if was introduced in 1990? Actually it was a server main intended to use for by crystallography. But the team is used, and I suggest all of you each of this method because are free, you can validate the structure. You can learn to work to the server. Yes. Okay, well then, yes, please. Tell me. Thank you, Anna. Yes, 1990. Thanks. Why is it still used in NMR? Because it provides information about anomalous bone length and bone angle. Bumps, which bumps means atomic overlap, very common in NMR sort of structures. Anomaly bone length and bone angle is also happened in X-ray structures, because when they build the structure, they strain the bone length and bone angle in order to fit the electron density, because it's not a geometry, but problem used with crystallography to fit structures. And they make evaluation of torsional angle, very common problem also in NMR structure, that you evaluate, for example, and you find out that the ominous torsion, which is the plant, usually the plant, you make it 70 degrees, 180. I mean, usually standard used to be 180 plus minus 10, but you get strange numbers. And what does strange numbers happen for? Because when you have this program, and you use like a black box to determine the structure, you have constraints, and then these constraints say, oh, these two hydrogens should be closer, and then you want to be closer, and the energy of the system be lower, and satisfy the hydrogen bonding, and then it's something, and you put the strong value for everything, and the structure starts to be deformed, to satisfy all these constraints.
and then you go to wrong value of some personal assets. Very common thing that happens with the money. So this program is very useful in that sense. The idea what project, and project also is very useful. Look, this is a Ramachandran map of an NMR structure. The red is the, what is called the allowed regions, the Ramachandran. These are defined by the large database of high resolution accuracy. So whatever you have a torsional phi psi, which is out of the red in the yellow, is called the this is the most favorable, and this is called the allowed region, and beyond the allowed region is wrong. You see a lot of wrongs. Look this music here, look this argent here, this argent here, and there, this alanine. I mean a lot of wrong amino acids in the wrong place. What means wrong? Mean that it's from the statistic point of view a very low probability. Doesn't mean that it's impossible, but the probability is very low. And usually it's true. When you take any of these extractions and you refine, you can remove all of these wrong notions. That's what this useful this they change the stereo quality of the test. They are very important. So every time, keep in mind, it doesn't matter if you take away your NMR, just go first and check how good it is. Project is very useful for VSVS also is an integrate from several widely used structural quality evaluation tools. Very useful because sometimes when you go to the PDB, especially people who produce NMR, they also deposit the constraints. The NOE constraint, and the discussion, and everything. You can upload here, and this program will give you evaluation of how many number of violations, within which range of the violation are, where they are, and many, many things. This is really very nice program by the group of Anfeglione, at Russia. It's a spectroscopy, but it's a big lab. And they have several others which I don't even mention, like more probity, verified 3D, ROSA 2, and so on and so forth. I don't want to spend time explaining everything possible. Several, because there are many. And this is C-Shift. C-Shift, I mean, the acronym comes from chemical shift. That we build, and it's a web server for protein structure validation, which is based on the quantum mechanics database of the C13 alpha shield. I will go through this very briefly, but I like that the Dolores already explained a lot about shields. So I will skip many things. Look, this is what was a standard output of our server. You put the PDB the structure in the PDB code and format, and they provide for each of the model, up to 20 model, chemical sheet for the C13. Why we choose C13 among so many nuclei that the protein have their carbon, they have C13, they have C13, they have prime, they have oxygen, nitrogen, why the first thing is they are ubiquitous to proteins. That means ubiquitous. Well, you choose carbon beta, they rise in carbon. If you choose proton, it's everywhere, it's very natural, abundant, they are a lot of overlapping, and also proton are very well exposed in the solvent, and they are very much important interaction that will influence the shield and this great problem from theoretical constitution. These are very well protected, I mean they are very well protected from solvent. They are good. Because for the side chain and rest of the platform. So, because no additional NMR experiment results are needed to be acquired, let's say you don't need the NOE to determine the chemical sheet, and the quantum mechanic basis of the method that we will discuss a little bit provides a standard with which to judge the qualities of reported extractions. That is what validation is. You have a method to judge the quality of the part of the structure. And also because you have potential value to be adopted as a standard with which to improve the quality of a reported structure. That is what we would call refining. So we have the two words that we need to use several times. Validation and refining. So let me go through the background of Cheshire. I will go very briefly because I will give a very brief explanation of this. You have intensity, and then you have frequency, and then you took a carbonate, you remove all the electrons. You took the nuclear, you put in a magnetic field, variable magnetic, you have to play with the frequency, and then there is a moment that you get present. And this is what is called the nuclear magnetic resonance. Now, if you put back the electron and do the same experiment, you get another frequency. Now, we said that there is a shift in frequency. And the origin, the physical origin of this also was already explained, is when you have the naked nucleus, you have a frequency in the magnetic field, omega 7. When you put the electron, the frequency is shifted. And the reason is that the electrons are protecting the nucleus, they generate a magnetic field, which the nucleus don't see the applied field, but see an effective field, which is shielded by the electrons. That's why we say that the electrons shield the nucleus. And this is our parameter of interest, that we need to compute the shield. Why? Well, because you can imagine now that everything that happens to the electrons around the nucleus will sense by having a different resonance. This very different resonance maybe can be used, for example, to the macroscopic of the system. And that's what you do. You want to compute shieldings to see if we can decode the information that there is in the chemical shield. I use the word shielding and chemical shield. They are not the same thing. They are related to the reference I will talk later, but it's a matter of reference what is in between. What you compute is shielding, and what you really want to know are chemical shield, because it is what you let the micron. And, well, the problem is possible to compute shield. And the answer is yes. We need to solve something which is far from being easy, which is called the Schrödinger equation, except in very special cases. H is the Hamiltonian applied to the position of the electron nuclei in our molecule. E is called the energy constant. And 5 is called, when it's a solution, is called an eigenfunction. And A is called eigenvalue. But usually we are in most of application forced to make guesses about what 5 is. And one way to make guesses is to write what is called basis set. Basis set is a collection of mathematical functions. Usually you choose the proper one. You may have a good solution. And then you can use some method to solve the equation. DFT, one of the methods, is the acronym for density functional theory. And was started in quantum chemistry around 1990. And there has been a lot of DFT methods. One of the main problems when you go into the field is which one is the good one. And this is not an easy answer. We try several, we choose one, and then we were able. But the main reason why we were able to solve the shielding is because there are problems we already do. One of the main and more common problems, powerful problem, is called Gaussian. There are several versions, 98, 309, all of them, it doesn't matter what, can be used to compute shielding. Now, the problem, we know that we can use problem to compute shielding, the problem is how to compute shielding problem. Look, if you take a whole protein and want to compute, it doesn't matter which basis set, this set of functions you use to approximate the function to solve this problem. It doesn't matter which function you use, you will not be able to solve it. This is large systems will be treated at quantum chemical level. So what we did is, we cut the residue in the conformation that is already in the protein, we put in a tripeptide surrounded by glycine just to provide the electron environment, not the sequence, but the electron environment, and then we compute the shielding for each of the amino acids in the sequence. These are shieldings, and then the shieldings, when we use a reference shielding, can be converted to chemical shield. We can compare with the observed chemical shield. Now, we have several approximations here. One of them, very strong, is we put the residue surrounded by glycine, and this is immediately considered. How to know that it's not influenced by the identity of the neural network? What we have here, I will show you. The point is that this way to compute shielding allow us to compute each residue in one process. What does it mean? That if you have 180 residue protein, you need 150 processes, so the computation of time is the time that it will take to run in one process. Usually, 3 or 4 hours, when you use an extended sequence of the beauty of this is you can use a smaller base itself, and you get almost the same result in much less time. We will show it, because I want to go into detail. I will give you a reference. Chapter before, and there is a lot of information there. You can read there's a lot of other references that you refer to, but if you're interested, can read it and get all this information. But the point is, the crucial thing here is we managed to compute shielding in protein just simply cutting the amino acid low. Keep in mind one very important point. When you cut, you preserve the file size, cal 1, cal 2, cal 3, whatever, exactly how appear in the protein. You just simply surround it by glycine. Glycine are free to move or avoid overlapping to this structure. If the structure is frozen, yeah, you cannot touch it, because if you touch the tracker, you will compute the shielding of something else, not the shielding of the amino acid. Now, this is the brief resume about the method. I will talk about what means regularized geometry, but we use this tripeptide, block tripeptide. You don't want to have charges here. It's the residue in the protein, so surrounded by glycine, which you and blue blocking here to avoid super ion. And then we compute the chemical shift by simply computing shielding and resting from the reference. That will take, we should take on the most easy one. There is many other reasons. I don't want to spend time explaining the problem. So everything is a problem. But we managed to compute chemical shift from using this method. But this approximation is not a minor approximation. Ah, by the way, the shielding are computed by using the software instructions. The problem of the regular geometry has to do with something you will see later. Oh, because you can compute shielding instead of the FCL experimental point of view, and then what you do is compute an effective Dixieland, and then you do conversion to DSS or any other one by simply shifting number, which are a wonderful thing for you. Doable in Dixieland. Doable. We did a nice job. I mean, not because we did, but it was very nice to do the calculation. See how well they got to use that faith. And the computer should be important to compute, because when you compute, you need to compute in the reference with the same approximation you use to compute the shield, because otherwise you will have to shift, so you need to make a reference. Anyway, why we use regularized geometry? When you study, you will see later, protein, usually you work with the fourth field. Fourth field is a collection of mathematical expressions that describe all the interactions that produce in the protein. And the internal energy usually is given by energy of the bond length and bond angle, torsional energy, electrostatic, and no bonding. These are a common expression for all four fields for the torsional. These are expression for all four fields. When I said all four fields, I'm talking about chroma, jam, amber. It doesn't matter. Is it? It's not very well, but it's all four fields. It is characterized because the bone length and bone angle are not wide. In this, bone length and bone angle is fixed. It's called rigid geometric approximation. In most of the other four fields, bone angles are able to move, and bone length a little bit of spread. But in ESEP, this called rigid geometry, they were determined by high accuracy more organic compound. So these are really very, very, very good approximation. So we use this bone length and bone angle in protein like thin. And it's aminoacid as its own, but at least. And this is what is called regularized geometry. This is the important also of the regularized geometry. Because somebody may say, well, you don't like because they move or what? No. Because quantum chemical calculations are extremely sensitive to bone length and bone angle. Very sensitive. Not extremely, but very sensitive. Let's say, if this is an example, we compute chemical shift of ubiquitin. One UBQ is the structure of ubiquitin solved by X-ray crystallography at 1.8 amps. This is high accuracy in terms of X-ray. And the chemical shift RMSD between observed and computed was 3.3 ppm. When we compute the same chemical shift using regularized, I mean fixed geometry, we got a chemical shift of 2.4 ppm. And to show how sensitive they are, is that the difference between the rigid geometry and the flexible geometry, between the structure, is only 0.14 amps. So it's really very tiny difference. I mean, these two structures are really very similar. But still, the chemical shifts are very sensitive to the geometry. Remember, in crystallography, the probes don't fit because they need flexible geometry, because they need to fit the electron density. Well, we always regularize geometry when we compute chemical shifts. And this is an important point. All structures are first regularized for consistency comparison between computed and experimental chemical shift. I mean, if we talk, we take several conformations, we don't care where the conformation, which method we use to derive this conformation, we regularize first and then we compute chemical shift. Because the chemical shift is computed. I told you before, we use the assumption that if we put the amino acids of one by glycine, it's a good method. Actually, we didn't prove it several years later, and we did that test. And what we found is that the interesting thing is that there is only influence for residues we are preceding proline. This is the difference, this delta-delta, are the difference between chemical shift computed for the residue when it's surrounded by glycine minus the chemical shift when the residue is computed by the real neighbors. So there is the difference. You will see the influence of the real neighbor compared with the computation with the neighbor at glycine. And what you see is that around 0.5 angstrom, 0.5 ppm, there is no difference except when the amino acid is preceding by proline. And this is a very well-known method. When the reason is preceding by proline, this has a strong influence in the chemical shift, and the reason were provided by Wisher. But anyway, the important point here is, this provides two answers. First, in general, it's a good approximation to surround the residue by glycine. And the second one is provide an answer, which is the accuracy of our method. I mean, we can think that about 0.5 ppm, any difference should be considered significant. Yes? Second? Take the fun. Yeah, but the, yes, the problem with this large part, I mean, we say always within 0.5. The problem is that we use one protein, solving the good people, and very rich in protein, actually, we have no main protein in the system. Our main there was protein, but we decided to try to see all the main and main was right. The problem is the frequency. Tryptophan, again, there were 2 or 3 of them. So, statistically, it doesn't have too much meaning. So there is a kind of cancellation later when you start to have more pregnancy. So we didn't pay attention to that. You can see very easy to do the number. For each ratio you will have 20 times 20 because you have less of that. So you have 600,000 confirmations using the dependent DNA. Multiply by 20, and you multiply again by 20, that will be roughly that. It's a really very large number. Maybe the problem unsolved. You cannot. At the end, I will mention something which is very, very good point, but it's related with the party. He was concerned how much we need to do or spend time if we want to compute real paper. And believe me, it's a huge number, I will explain later in my text. So, these are the main approximations of the method. Gas phase quantum chemical calculation. All the ionizable ratio we are considered neutral. Remember, there are 6 out of 20 which are ionizable, strong ionizable. Arsenic, lysine, and tyrosine. All the structures are first regularized, which is called SFP geometry. We use an effective tetrametoxazine reference equal to 184.5 ppm, and no nearest neighbor effect other than protein were considered during the calculation. Yes? Yes? We use ECPP3 because of 5. It has to do only with parameterization of the protein, but it's exactly the same thing. That's the difference here. So, the first thing that it came out to our mind was, well, let's try to test the methodology. And we choose this one. Why we choose this one? I will explain very briefly. This one protein, 1TGQ, now obsolete. The protein data bank, you have many protein which are called obsolete. These obsolete protein are protein who were solved, they're positive, and they can be drawn. But I like the idea of the protein data bank, because the positive comes in there, it's like in Las Vegas, it stays there. Because later, you can use this information, and you use the obsolete, and the replacing one, and then you can see the difference, and then you can explain the difference. Why we choose this protein? This protein survives to all servers. Check. I mean, you check with ProCheck, you check with many servers, this protein and this protein look undistinguished. What's the difference between this protein? Essentially, this long helix, which is striped, and it's broken here. And why this happened? Because in solution, this protein is a dimer and was solved like a monomer. That is one of the big problems of the high throughput NMR production of the structure. Because we cannot do that because we need to know how the structure is in solution. The structure in dimer may be completely different to what is at the moment. Why is this problem appears? Very easy. Look, let me tell you what is the origin of the problem. In the experiment appeared an NOE between two protons. When you want to satisfy the NOE with this structure, assuming that it's a monomer, you need to break the helix. But when you solve like a dimer, no, because you take the protein, you switch, and then the dimer, the NOE appears naturally between these two helix. You don't need to break anything. So this is break, oops. This is break. To satisfy the NOE, you don't need to break this structure in a dimer. Now, what we did is we compute the chemical shift just for the helix. I mean, we took the from the PDB the portion of helix here, and we compute the chemical shift for the portion of the helix here. And that's what we did here. This is the plot here, Red, green is the dimer, red are the breaking structure of the obsolete dimer. And it's very easy to identify at a set of points here, which is departed from the diagonal very much. And when you take a look at the structure of this point, you're surprised at exactly the residues which are in the bend. Why? Well, semi-cassip are very sensitive to torsion. Very sensitive. And this is an example of how sensitive they are. I mean, when you do the calculation easily, you can see the difference. So we thought that is good enough, because as a validation, don't only allow us to give an idea how good is the structure, but even more important, to determine where the flaw. I like the word flaw in English, because you have a lot of synonyms. Flaws is error, mistake, a lot of things. So you don't need to say that it's an error, maybe a mistake, maybe not. So we did this calculation and we liked very much. And then we thought, why we need to completely for every structure? I mean, why for every structure we need to go and do the calculation? Then we have the Ramachandran map. This Ramachandran map has been built for more than 1500 high accurate A-grade structure. The red part of the Ramachandran map indicates the highly more populated region of the Ramachandran. One not to explore all possible conformations in the Ramachandran map. And then compute the chemical shift, and then we build a lookup table, and then we can use the lookup table to, doesn't matter which is the structure, because we have the Ramachandran map already computed. We go there, we compute the pi size for the pi size, so this is the computed pi size. I mean, you have all the pi size, then you have a structure, you see which pi size. Oh, okay, I go to the Ramachandran, I have the value. If I don't have the value, I have the near closer value, I can do a calculation. And then it provides immediately, very fast, the chemical shift of this value, which has been already pre-computed, because we built a database. And that's what we did. We built a database of 600,000 conformations for all 20 natural occurring amino acids. That is what is behind the server. I mean, this database, what they use is a server where not only phi and psi and omega are explored, but also we consider information from chi 1 and chi 2. In other words, what we did is we sampled the phi psi every 30 degrees, we sampled chi 1 every 30 degrees, and we sampled chi 2 for the most frequently seen chi 2 in protein according with the large database of sources. So the total number is, we have a lookup table where to go, and I hope you can use in this course the server to play. And if you see something wrong, then, but I mean, no, the idea is you can use to validate the structure. I mean, if you play later doing some kind of homology modeling, try to choose the homology modeling for which the chemical shift are, and use our server to check out where your model is compared with the experiment. Should be. Anyway, we did the Cheshire server. We are only alone? No, we are not. There are a lot of servers in chemical sheets, and some of them very good. And some of them, no, most of them predict most chemical sheets that we do. Why? Because we predict chemical sheets only for 613 alpha, and you took many of these servers and they produce chemical sheets for 13 alpha, 13 beta, proton, nitrogen, carbonyl, oxygen, whatever. Historically, the first server, which actually was the FD basis, was shift S from the case group. Later, shift X used neural network like a like a Sparta and ProShift. They use a large database of chemical sheets for which they create a structure. They use neural network, they train the neural network, then the network learns, not you, that for a given portion, the corresponding chemical shift is this or that. They are very good with that. They can do for a nuclear. for us was very difficult because we do this quantum chemical calculation and every nucleus has a different complexity. I will refer briefly to that.
Now, when we compare our prediction for carbon alpha with the carbon alpha predicted by all the servers, our prediction in terms of R, the relation between predicted and observed, was the one.
But we were completely confused at that time.
Until we realized that we can do a very nice experiment. And we did experiment. Remember, we used only carbon alpha because they produce other,
and we compare. And the correlation for us was always the one.
They say, for us 1.8, for the first one 4.9.
What we can do? Why we don't check what is the meaning of our correlation?
Why we don't check the meaning? So we try this experiment, which I like very much. We took this protein, 1RGE, which has been a very high accuracy, so 1.15 alpha. It's a protein that contains two identical but crystallographically independent molecules in the unit cell. The C alpha RMSD is 0.4 angstrom, and the whole atom RMSD between these two crystal units in the crystal is only 1.1 angstrom, and the difference between these two is mainly because the side chain occupy different photometric.
In other words, we have two units very similar, but not identical. I don't care about the observed area. What we did is we use any of these servers, we fit with this structure, we produce the 13 alpha chemical series. Then we fit with this structure, and then we predict the chemical series. And then we did a correlation between change A predicted versus change B. What we want to know is the prediction for a server using model A or model B, if R equal 1, means that this server cannot discriminate A from B. Well, this is exactly what we found. When we compute the correlation for each of the servers, what we found is the lower correlation for us, a little bit higher for shift S, which also has a basic in the course of EST computing, and all the other three was one. So our conclusion was, sometimes lower R value doesn't necessarily mean poor accuracy, but on the contrary, it could mean higher sensitivity to the effect subtle structural engineering. I mean, in some way, we found an answer to our concern. Why our correlation are always lower? And the problem is that you have a method which is really sensitive, all the would be lower. Because even if you try things which are very similar, all the others will say, okay, they are the same. They are not. And this is an example. They are not. So we like this. And so we get encouraged with this, and this is how validation should be done. We have the server now. We need to provide the server with an input, which is the coordinate of the protein in the PDB format. This is already a format for the coordinate. With what we get from the output, we have the chemical sheet computed, C13 chemical sheet for all conformation of the sample. I said all conformation of the sample because when you work with NMR structure, you don't get one structure. If you want to see any deposited structures, just for few exceptions, you have at least one. Sometimes 10, most of the time 20, even sometimes more. When you do the analysis, you use the computed and the observed chemical sheet to compute what is called the conformational RHRMSD. This is a very interesting point, I'll explain you why. The observed chemical sheet, the observed, not the computer, represents the contribution from several conformers to the existing solution. This is a very important point behind the evaluation of the quality of an structure. The structure in solution question is not one, it's a Boltzmann analysis. This is correct, although we never compute Boltzmann analysis. But this is the basic idea. What the spectroscopy provides is for a chain of n residue length, M-conformer. These are the M-conformer. Let's assume you take a look of the residue I for each of these residues. What you do is first, you compute the average among all the residues, and the average value you compare with the observer. Why? Because it doesn't make any sense to compare this one with the observer, this one with the observer, because maybe all of them are in solution. So what is observed is an average among all of them. Actually, it should be Boltzmann average, but Boltzmann average if you compute, so you can think about plain average. So, it's what is written here. For the I residue, you compare the deviation between the observed and chemical shift and the corresponding computed chemical shift average over all the sample of the end conformation. That's a very important point. That's why I write this. I guess it's the only question I have. The conformational RMSD is not the RMSD. Is the RMSD only when you have one conformation? Let's say, when the curtain is an egg residue. Otherwise, what you do, you compare the observed chemical shift with the average over all, the same ratio over all the conformation deposited by the person. And this is what we call the conformational average RMSD, and this, we call this new scoring function to be used to evaluate the quality of the protein as a whole. This RMSD is given an idea of the protein quality as a whole. Doesn't tell us if there is any problem in some part of the structure. I will talk about later. When you can not only evaluate the whole structure, but also details of the structure. Well, this is a test that we did. We use more than 10,000 amino acids. This is ubiquitin. Very well-known protein solved by many means, by theoretical 128 conformation from the Ventruscolo group, by NMR from the Bax group, then mold, and then you have one structure solved very high accuracy by X-ray. And you have a lot of them. What we did, we compute for all of them, and then this is our result. These are greens are each of the 10 models of the NMR solved by Bax through red-gray gray structure. And here you can see, you can imagine, there is a red there. This is the gray. And these are 128 models from 1XQ2. I put the PDB so you can go and look at what the structure is going to do. And the solid line is what we call the conformational average MRD. And this solid line represents the quality of the fractal atomic sample. Not individual bars. Individual bars are the RMSD of each of the structures. But the each of the structure RMSD doesn't have any meaning because the observed value is an average for the conformation. So you should compare solid line against the red bar, which is the gray structure, which is only one. And in any case, the solid line is lower than the red. I mean, any of these structures, in our opinion, is better representation of ubiquitin solution than the egg-ray structure. Crystallographers don't like it. Why? Well, they said, why do you use one structure? So, and we were wondering, yes, you are right, why do you use one structure? I mean, is one structure good enough in crystallography? Take a look. We took the electron density of the X-ray structure. And this is the solution proposed by the crystallography for the undeposited, the PDB called 1U-lithium. We took this electron density and we generate further structures which have similar quality to the deposit one, with the same, with R factor and another 54 R factor. I mean, all six structures here satisfy the electron density is similar to when we compute the chemical shift for all five, not for the red one, but for all five, actually same. That solid line is below 2.4 ppm. Now, if you come back, 2.4 ppm is better than any NMR of this one. So, the conclusion was, an ensemble rather than a single conformation may be a better representation of a protein solution in solution and in a crate.
point is that the Lord recognized to produce only one. We are not the first one saying that. Yes.
Say again. I guess it should be I don't remember, it's in the month, it's very small.
Oh yeah, 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 very small.
But chemical chip are very sensitive.
Anyway,
the main point is we try to push the telegraphy, don't produce one extraction, you can produce several. They know that they can produce several, but they think they want to come.
I don't know what is the reason, because even the telegraphy question why they produce one, when there is more than one. I mean, what they like to do sometimes is put the big factor, when something is very flexible. But probably in place to put big factor, where you make several structures, satisfying or probably position of the of the loops. That's what we learn from this. I mean, we like it. We like it. We believe that in solution, several extractors are better representation of a single extraction. No? Yeah. No, 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 it's it. No, it's it. Look, what happened is, she was wondering whether the X-ray extractor really exists. No, the X-ray is safe.
Very
flexible. Don't get the wrong impression. It's very good. Very good method. But more important is the structure is in the thick part, not in water. It's solid. It's 60% volume. So they are really also important. Say that you have a critical factor. And this sometimes cause some portion to be frozen compared with what you see in solution. Some loops, or some flexible, you know, but we believe it's more practical for us, in our opinion, when you have more than one more. In terms of chemical sheet, we are talking about chemical sheet. Many cryptographers will say, look, if you look at electron density and you fit the electron density with this, there is only one which is the present. You may not lie. But how we evaluate the structure is in terms of another observer, which is the chemical sheet. The solution, one structure is not good enough. No, it doesn't mean that it's wrong. You look at a thing like the Rodolfo Arts, are very similar to the Rodolfo Arts. But I try to question why we should consider or go or move into the direction to consider few like better. Maybe many are better. The point is, we reached this point and the question is, do we need any validation method? What for? Well, because a good validation method should provide information not only where the flaw, the error, the mistake are, but how to fix it. That's the idea of validation method. So we try to work on this idea, because so far no validation method with this characteristic. And then we developed this, what we call SHIFT-2, which is a method which not only is telling you that the method that you are supposed to use not only telling you where the error are, but also provide some solution for the thing. Doesn't mean that you will fix it. Maybe this. Anyway, but we try. In the SHIFT-2, we incorporate a new nucleus, carbon beta. With before we have only carbon alpha, we add now carbon beta to the calculation. Now, the first question that come out is, why do you put carbon beta? I mean, there is no enough information in carbon alpha? Or another question is carbon beta providing something that the carbon alpha don't do? Well, let's take a look with yourself. Why we don't try to check how sensitive to the rotation of chi-1, side-chain chi-1, is carbon alpha, carbon beta?
If you tell us whether we can get additional information, no, of course. What we did is the following. We compute, look, for each point of the Ramachandran, means that you have a structure in a fixed particle size. Exactly. And then you froze the kaiju in 30 degrees. Okay. What remained? Kaiwan. What do you do in Kaiwan? It froze Kaiwan, it froze kaiju, move Kaiwan every 30 degrees. When you finish, with all the chemical shift, you need to compute the average. And with the average, come out the standard deviation. Then you do this calculation for the C13 alpha and for the C13 beta. And what you make a difference is not the average, forget about average, because there are different nucleus, they have different numbers, so it doesn't make any sense. The standard deviation, because the standard deviation is giving you how much you departed from the mean value, with the sensitivity to the variations. So you compare standard deviation of alpha and beta, and what this number means, means that if this is negative, this is more sensitive to the type of variation. That's the only thing you know. Kaiwan. That's what this energy matter here. In most of them are negative numbers. Why? Carbon beta provide favor most sensitive are to the Kaiwan variation than the carbon atom. But on the other hand, carbon atom are more sensitive to the fact. It is not surprising. We did this for all of the rest. I mean, for most of the rest, you get this information. So we were convincing that the carbon alpha carbon beta do not provide the same information. We go ahead and we compute, we use a set of 95 proteins, high accuracy, whatever. We compute the error and then we put what is called the distribution of the error. For each residue, you compute that, the chemical sheet, and then you start your separate chemical sheet for each amino acid of the 95 proteins. And then you took all the error and jumped in the error with 0.5. This is what it is. This is a pin of all the errors, and the error you can see is around the zero, which is okay, and the standard deviation is telling you how much they departed from the mean value. And we do for the alpha and we do also for the beta. The sigmas are different. This is an histogram of errors. So what we want to do is to see a graphic interface. Why a graphic interface? Because spectroscopy are very pushy guys. They want us not to make numbers, they want to see figures. So they want to see in color when something is wrong. They don't want to have a number that says, look, this number is bigger than, and then you need to put the square root of. No, they want a figure. And put on the screen and say, oh, look, if this is wrong. Okay, then we decide, okay, let's then what we want to see. And then we decided, look, if you choose everything within one sigma green, which is here, we said this is a good chemical shape. Means that this residue and the observer, they match very well. If the difference between the observer and the computer is two sigma, it's yellow, means, watch out, don't make up a problem. But if bigger than 2 sigma, red, we said, look, something is wrong. It should be better. That is what green is. And how do you divide green, yellow, and red? It will depend. Sigma is 177 for carbon beta and 170 for carbon alpha. Not the same. Because there are different nucleus, they have different sensitivities. So, let me show you very briefly an example of this validation. We took the lead. Is the conformation number 1 out of 10 conformations created in soil by NMR. Although we display one conformation, the analysis consider all 10. Meaning the error or the difference is not of the conformation number 1. They are show on conformation number 1. That they were computed, we should call them. And this is the X-ray structure, this is a one conformation. this is the color distribution when you use only carbon alpha chemical sheet to validate. What they said, look, you have a problem in carbon thermo, carbon alpha of this residue. And you have several here. And you look carbon beta now, what is the carbon alpha? And say, oh, carbon beta, this looks very good. You still have a couple of problems here. What happens when you use carbon alpha, carbon beta that we color blue here? You know what this means? We decide to color blue because we realize that blue is any residue which is not green, that moves the torsional, not the fact the torsional to certain values, you convert in green. So blue colors means that you can fix just unity cycles. Tyrone, or tetrum, or both. So you can fix most of the error using carbon alpha, carbon beta, if you are able to move the side chain. Forget carbon. Carbon is thick. I don't want to touch carbon. Carbon is a very serious problem. This is the output, part of the output of the spaceship, I explained very briefly. In this part of the output, which is the first result, is telling you that lysine number 6, which is yellow for the carbon alpha validation and is green for carbon beta, can be converted to both green if you move the background is the same to the blue, but if you move to the this combination of side chain. I mean, if you manage to put any of this combination of side chain, you will get green. So we believe, when we did, we have a method not only to show where the error is, but we can tell into the spectroscopy or whatever is working with the structure, look, to make a small difference of the size, you can improve your result. You can compare to green, and green means that your chemical sheet will be very well matching your certain parts. The program also needs, in the second part, those residues which are green, but are not in the most populated region of the Ramachandra. Why? Because the chemical sheet has a problem. The chemical sheet is telling you nothing about whether the residue is in a lower region or is completely a lower region. It's a number. So you may have a residue which is in the wrong region of the Ramachandra, green. So it's a warning to the people who do the validation, be careful. You are getting green for these residues, but these residues are not populating the most populated region of the function. And there is a third information that is provided in the server in the last part, is that many times you have observed values, you are comparing against observed values, but many times you get observed values, and this observed value is the sigma of the average of the positive observed value for this residue in the database of chemical sheet. The database of chemical sheet is called BMRV. And when you enter in BMRV, let's say you take arginine, there are 10,000 carbon alpha arginine. And then you have a mean value for the observed, all arginine observed, and then you have a standard deviation. When you use this standard deviation, experimental. Because why? Because sometimes there are errors in the observed value. Experimental is impossible, it may be a typo, maybe whatever is the reason, and then it's indicated later that it's a red in your structure, but it's not because it's red, because something wrong, but it's a red because the observed value is beyond the mean value of the observed value for this red, so don't pay attention. I have a question I am saying to me, but I want to explain what you did. That's what we did also. We did this analysis. We took this structure, I remember I told you, blue with the fixing. We did the fixing without touching the pattern and without using NOE. Why? Because we want to see how well we can move side chain, fix chemical sheet, and how much NOE we violate. We did, we fixed all of this. Still there are some blue, why? Because we couldn't fix it. there are some yellow
because they don't have solution. I mean, we don't have white improvements yet, so we remain here.
But still, we improve a lot of them. We improve almost 90% of them. And although we violate a little bit more than we, red bar is our after requirement, and black bar is the deposit effect. We thought that we did quite well. This was done very in a very primitive manner. I mean, what was done is was almost done manually. Move the side chain and then relax a little bit, and then everything closes because you don't want to move that chain. And if you have overlapping, you look another solution because usually the several solutions will several. And if you don't find any solution, you keep what you have. And this happened with the blue. This was not possible to do because you create any overlapping or violate from the later individual group, but because they were very well done. Conclusion. We think we provide a new validation with the cafe sensitivity of 90% and provide torsional solution angle to little optimal agreement in C alpha and C beta chemical sheet for almost 94% of the five proteins we have. We believe that all together, using with other constraints, can be used for future methods of the plant. I will ask you, all of you, in some moment, to go into this googlethisspecies.com and play with it. The server has some limitations. For example, it does not support the missing atoms in the series. So if there is missing PDB atoms, it will be zero error, and we can continue. But there is mismatch also, because many times information from chemical sheet is from NMR structure, and the information from the X-ray structure, for example, or PDB structure, is from analog structure that is not identical, to make up some different and they are some different. Try to look for a structure that is not so much easier to use as a test. The advantage is well, the method can be used for protein of any class or size. There is no limitation of alpha, beta, eta, or the 1,000 residues, 1 residue, 20 residues, doesn't matter. It's a strong methodology with which evaluate the quality of the protein as a whole using what we call C alpha MLT, and also to detect flaws and repair. And this has to do with the question that Rodolfo asked. What happens to the neighbor? Because it will come out to our mind immediately, why we don't consider contribution to this planet? The planet is very interesting. And also, when you look into the computer, in the paper, there's a paper by Neil, where they compare several servers, seven, and the walls. But the correlation is 0.6. So it's a big one. What we did is we tried to analyze how what we should take into account if we want to compute C prime chemical sheet with a similar accuracy that we compute C alpha. In other words, within 0.5 ppm. What we need to consider. And that's what our surprise was. You need to consider phi psi of the same residue of the C prime, chi 1, phi y and C y of the net residue, and the nature of the residue. Why, when you compare C 13 alpha, you only care about the same residue from matter the near network. So the result is computation of these at a quality similar to this in terms of accuracy will take 10 to the 2 times communication time. And this is something we can remind. Remember, we use 600,000 dimensions that multiplied by 2 times. That's the bigger number. This is huge. That's the bigger sense. So we decided to stop here, but at least we found a reason why we cannot compute it. And the problem is that dependence of this ratio or the identity, all of them are going to be 1.5 billion. All of them. Somebody may come in the future with a very good idea, smarter than us, and cool. Chemical sheet contain a lot of coded information, electronic, something to code. But cutting the determination using chemical sheet is something which is not new, but not too old. They start with some approximation using, I will skip this very fast, but by Kusevich and Kronepon and Kroll in 1995, they use what is called the conformation sheet, that's what we mentioned. We come up with this idea to use C13 alpha, and then appear Robustelli using a method which is called Kamp sheet. And Kamp sheet is a method of the dynamical sheet using atom positions. So what is that? What is that for? They can use molecular dynamics. And later, Rosato Ramini, the paper that I guess Rodolfo showed, where there was a test, a blind test, about several how they produce and qualities. I'm sorry, I want to skip this. Let me tell you very briefly about conformation of sheets, as Rodolfo mentioned. What conformation of sheets? Conformation of sheets I use for almost every method used in NMR spectroscopy, because the idea is extremely simple and come from a paper from Jack Fehrenbach in 1991. And what Fehrenbach found was something to have very good empirical observation was that when you make a difference between the observed chemical sheet and the chemical sheet that you will have in this ratio where in a statistical called conformation, that is called conformational sheet, this is what you get empirical. That all the ratios which are in alpha helical shift around 40 million, concept, to the left. But if they were the same ratio were in the beta shift, they are shift to the left. So, what do you need here? The observed value and a good prediction of a statistical code. And how you get good statistical code? Good question, there is no one. But there are some good approximations. The experimentalist Simbundi and Rubi in the 70s, they produced a statistical code using this Green-X Adam, and later Peter Bryan and Dyson, they used Green-X in the block, the Adam block in different sources. They are quite similar. The problem is, we show something as well that when you have mechanical, so it's an unblock. When you have mechanical, you did the simulation, and what we found that the statistical code not such a thing, because the side chain of mechanical, what do you think I'd like to do? It's a negative charge. We go to the internet. This is what we do. Move to the internet. So in many cases, like a glutamic acid, sometimes in an they are stuck. Not what you think. It's not that you think that they are sampling and in solution is this thing like crazy because it's surrounded by all of the plants. So, but anyway, the method is very good. And when you do the comparison, what does it mean? Well, it means that it's very easy. You can determine the portion which are morphogenics or in beta. But you don't have nothing in between. What do you mean nothing in between? Well, if the ratio is not in alpha helix, it's not in beta, you don't have nothing with conformation of shift. And the question is, what's the problem with that? Well, 50% of the ratio are not alpha, not in beta. So you have half of the problem. That is the problem. Okay, I don't want to spend time, but this is our method. Our method do not need what we do is different. We use what we call the minimal modularity, let me tell you very briefly what we do. We start with the conformational sheet. Remember the alpha and beta portion? Something you will know. Okay. We use this plus NOA as constraints, and then we produce lots of effects. Many effects. How many effects do you want? Many. And then what we do is we just keep it a small number. We remove everything who violate NOA with 1.6. If you have a lot of effects. What we do is we use a lot of effects that we filter, saying they violate all this NOA. And then we go residue by residue for a bunch of extractors, let's say 1,000, that's not the number. Residue by residue, what we do, we choose the residue that in the conformation that best matches the certain conformation. You know what you get? You get a structure which exists, but it's a structure which has the narrowity almost zero. What does it mean? Well, because every ratio of this structure has a very good match with the surface conformation. And then you need a question is what do you get for this structure to not exist? Remember, you start with a conformational shape. In a conformational shape, what do you get? You get 5 and psi. For all residues, no, for use only in alpha helix or beta shape, which actually are 50% of the ratio. What do you get with the minimum model that you You get 5, you get psi, you get type 1, you get type 2, all of them. What is good for? Now you have constraints on the portion for all of them. Not for 50% of them and only the right. You have for all of them. And this is very fast and very extremely fast and very easy to do. I will not go there. This is the test, a blind test with people from Rutgers. They provide that with the NOA and chemical shape. We start with the, this is a conformational shape, you see. So, two portions in green which are alpha helix, and red are, we don't know what. This is a partial structure, remember I told you? This is what we get. This is what we get with this information and the NOA. This is what you see there. What we did is, this is what I mentioned here. We look for residue by residue, the residue of each conformation that best matches it. And then we use this as constraints, plus the noise, and we get this. Very much stuff. And what we did, we repeat the calculation. Why? Because still you have an example. So we did again, residue by residue. We define a new set, and this is that the one we compare with the already published and well, what very, very, very similar with because this character was sold at that time with Payet Gray and Ophel Lamarck, so we have time to compare without knowing the structure because the character was in this house. We do but beta shift as well. Well, the conclusion about method, we abandoned the idea to use chemical shift for coordination. Not really we abandoned, but we faced problems that people were much more smarter than us, in the sense that people like Jose, which is a unique, a very good method to solve. So what they do is very fast. We use all these methods that we mentioned, the portrait quality center, and it's an Orlando portrait, and you have a lot of problems with this hole in the field of protein only the most serious problem, the multi-minimal problem. I mean, you get stuck. Usually in conformation which are low energy, and change conformation in nature, you lose a lot of time, and people like Rosetta, they wonderful to make them small fragments, all the fragments. I mean, they were successful. They succeed with it. It is probably the best way to do it, and we try to move in this direction, is to move our idea to Rosetta, because our own method didn't work in the first way. It's not that the method of the chemical shift didn't work, it's the method of conformation itself. It's a proper method of the problem for because of the multiple minimum problem. Well, these are the conclusions I want to thanks because, as you know, Universitas Madrid, the institute where I work, to Cornell, Agencia in Argentina, the NIH, and the people who have computed. This calculation, that was this calculation would not be possible without this supercomputer. Because we were talking about 600,000 confirmations on the internet, not something that was dead. It takes a lot of time, and of course, a lot of money.
Well, I hope you have an overview. By the way, if you do validation, and what my advice is, never skip other subjects. Never. So, in terms of the structure, I will say, don't be scared, be careful. Don't trust too much what you see. Yes. Go and check. That's not the key to the radio anymore. So I will check and do your own validation. Yes, it's my best part.